It's nice to know that our help comes from the Lord. It's nice to feel that fall and how the seasons are changing and how he's in control. It is getting colder, Dave, definitely in the evenings and mornings. If you leave your window open at night, you might not sleep as well as you wanted. Either get up in the middle of the night or you kind of suffer through. But time to find that extra blanket or whatever it is that you need. But we're just here to praise God. Praise him for the glory and the beauty. And each season kind of brings its pieces that are enjoyable. He never lets us get bored with it. He brings something new each morning to us. A couple of quick announcements before we get going. Women's Fellowship is not going to be this week. It's going to be Monday, October 7th at the Sablons at 6 o'clock, okay? Men's Fellowship will be the 8th, same time, and us guys, we kind of do it last minute, so we figure it out as we go along. So if you need to figure out where that is, make sure that one of us knows so that we can keep you in the loop as well. Other things going on, small groups, talking, to our community, making sure that they know. Basically, let's make sure that we're in people's lives, and not just our own, or not just each other's here, but that we're in our neighbors' lives, that we're in, the kids down the street, or our brother's kids, or whoever that happens to be. But let's be in the community's lives so that they can see Jesus shining through us, so that they can see something that they want as well. They can see what he has done and how he has changed our lives. At this time, take just a second to greet somebody, in front of you, behind you, to the side of you, but somewhere close, and then we'll continue worshiping him. Okay, at this time, if you'd please join me in the reading of God's word, and if you're able, please stand. We're going to be reading from Psalm chapter 14, verses 1 through 7. Psalm 14, 1 through 7. To the choir master of David. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They do abominable deeds. There is none who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on the children of man to see if there are any who understand, who seek after God. They have all turned aside. Together they have become corrupt. There is none who does good, not even one. Have they no knowledge? All the evildoers who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord? There they are in great terror, for God is with the generation of the righteous. You would shame the plans of the poor, but the Lord is his refuge. Oh, that salvation for Israel would come out of Zion. When the Lord restores the fortunes of his people, let Jacob rejoice. Let Israel be glad.
Down in Joseph's tomb, the Psalm chapter 28, verses 6 through 7. Blessed be the Lord, for he has heard the voice of my pleas for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts, and I am helped. My heart exults, and with my song I give thanks to him.
My God.
this morning I was reading in the Gospel of Luke, and I know it's not a coincidence. I know it's the Lord. But as I'm reading, I come on the story where Jesus tells his disciples to look over at the woman who gives it all. He talks about how the rich will give a portion, but she gave everything she had. And I had to sit there for a moment because I was like, gosh, do I give everything I have? Am I giving my all to the Lord? And it was like, he just told me, he's like, no, it's about just fully trusting me. It's not about your ability or what you can do. It's about what I am doing through you. So as we're worshiping this morning, let us not be focused on our abilities or on what we're doing, but on what God is doing. Let's focus on offering all of ourselves up to him. Everything that we own, everything that we have, the people in our lives, it is all from God. Lord Jesus, may we offer it all to you, Lord, as you gave it all for us. May we surrender it all at your feet, not holding on to one bit of it, not putting our trust in one bit of it, but putting our full and complete trust in you. And knowing that you hold the plan, you have the purpose, and all we have to do is just keep walking and keep moving forward and looking at you, keep trusting you. So, Lord Jesus, we come before you now. Be in this place. Honor us with your spirit. May he dwell among us. May he be speaking to our hearts right now.
Magnificent Holy Father, I stand in awe of all I see, of all the things you have created. Still you choose to think of me. Thank you.
Jesus, just show us every day how we offer our lives to you, Lord. Just draw us near to you. Reveal to us, Lord, areas where we need to surrender it over to you, Lord. Not to where we're fighting against you, Lord, and we don't want to give it up, Lord, but to where we're offering it, Lord, because you are what we want at the end of the day. You are who we want and who we desire above all else, Father God. We lay it all down at your feet, Lord Jesus, whatever it may be, Lord, whether it's a worry, Lord, or something that we've put our faith in, Lord, to some degree, we lay it down at your feet right now. I pray, Father God, that your Spirit be present here, that he be reigning in this place, that as we're listening to the word and as Pastor David is speaking, that your Spirit would anoint him and that he'd only speak your truth and he'd only speak exactly what you want, that he would be a tool and an instrument used for you, Lord. Come on this place right now, Lord. Open our hearts and open our minds. May we have ears to hear, Lord, and eyes to see. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you guys for joining us today. Well, I can't joke about the weather because Tim already did. But it was cold. It has been cold for the past few days. It was kind of crazy. It was warm at night, and we were able to have the window open a little while. And then all of a sudden, one morning, I woke up in the middle of the night, just like Brother Tim said, and it was cold. So we actually had the heater on last night, Lila and I. So, but praise the Lord. It's a beautiful day. As you guys know, we've been going through Romans. We're going to be continuing there today. We'll be in Romans chapter 3, just continuing there. And, this has been a hard teaching, and I will say I promised you that we were going to, come, out of the tunnel, if you will. Paul has been, forming this argument, this declaration, this proclamation, this statement to the world. To the Gentiles, in their wickedness of not knowing the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to the Jews who, for whatever reason believed that they, that their way, their religion, if you will, was the way to be right with God, was the way to be justified before God. And Paul has destroyed all of that up to this point so far, all the way through Romans chapter 3, verse 8, where we finished off last week. And so really what it boiled down to last week is that although the Jews are the chosen people of God, they were unfaithful with what God had given them. And so Paul wanted to destroy that idea that they had, that somehow by being a Jew, they just automatically were in. At the same time, Paul destroyed the idea from the Gentile who thought, well, I didn't know any better. I just didn't know, and so you can't hold me accountable to that. And, even though I sinned, even though I stand wrong before you, you can't hold me accountable to that. And so Paul has destroyed all of those ideas and brought us to this truth that all mankind, whether they're Jew or they're Gentile, stands unrighteous and therefore condemned before God, who is the only one who is righteous. He's been righteous always. He's been righteous since creation. He's righteous still today. He will always be righteous. And along with being righteous always, God is faithful always. He's faithful in all things. We talked about last week how he's faithful to judge unbelievers. And his righteous judgment on unbelievers is an expression of his faithfulness. We also talked about the fact that God is faithful to save believers, and that his righteous salvation is another expression of his faithfulness. And so, guys, if you haven't gotten anything out of what we've been talking about, what I do want you to understand at this point as we continue is that man is completely depraved and unrighteous, and God is completely and utterly righteous. And this is where we stand today. This is where Paul has brought everybody to today at this point in his writing, whether, again, you're a Jew or you're a Gentile. Everybody is unrighteous before God. Nobody is exempt from the righteous judgment of God. And so today, as we continue in Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 20, we will be discussing really what I would consider the conclusion of this really hard teaching. Again, as I often say, the gospel, the very word gospel means glad tidings or good news, is only good news because of the bad news. And so Paul has been spending all this time up to this point and through the verses we're going to be going through today to show us the bad news. I promise you after that, there'll be a lot of good news, okay? But we got to get here, guys, because look, a lot of people, they're like, you know, so what if I know Jesus? Who cares if I believe in Jesus? I don't care. Because they don't understand that they stand judged, they stand condemned, and that the wrath of God is upon them. And Jesus came to pour out the wrath of God for them. And so we really need to make sure that we understand this point, guys, okay? That we are completely unrighteous and God is righteous. And so we will be discussing the conclusion of this hard teaching. And we'll also be talking about God's justification, and it's going to be a two-part series that will take us all the way through chapter 3. But for today, we'll be in verses 9 through 20. I'm going to go ahead and read the text, and then we will go through it. Paul continues there in verse 9 of chapter 3, Romans. What then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. As it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their paths are ruin and misery. And the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. Let's pray one more time. Father, we thank you so much for your word. We just pray right now, Lord, as we go through this text, God, that you would speak through me by your Spirit. Empower me now, God, and let only your truth be spoken, God. And also, Lord, just give ears to hear and eyes to see and clear discernment and understanding for all that are hearing this message today, God. Impart to them whatever it is you want that they would need, God. And again, we pray all these things for your glory. Thank you for Jesus, and we pray these things in his name. Amen. So, Paul really, guys, remember I told you guys this, and I have been telling you guys this, that Paul is really speaking to what would be called like an objector of this teaching, that all people stand unrighteous before God. And I don't know if you guys can see that or not, and I hope you've been reading ahead, but really the last, all of, you know, like the verses we've read so far in chapter 3 and most of chapter 2 has been really kind of like against the Jews. And it's not that Paul is trying to hate his own countrymen. He actually loves them dearly. And he understands the fact and the truth that only by faith in Jesus Christ can anybody be saved. Not by blood, not by religion, not by what we think or what we can do or any of that business. It's only by faith in Jesus Christ, by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ. And so Paul really is trying to get people to understand this. That's the first thing. The second thing is he doesn't want the Jews to confuse the Gentiles into believing that somehow they have to become a Jew and believe in Jesus to get saved. As I said a couple of weeks ago, we see this play out in Acts chapter 15 when Paul and Barnabas had to come to Jerusalem. And they were like, you know, arguing against Jews that were trying to get Gentiles to be circumcised. In other words, become Jewish and believe in Jesus to be saved. And the conclusion of the matter there was simply this, that the Gentiles didn't have to become Jew. They just had to put their faith in Jesus Christ. And there were some things that they were left to do, right? But the fact is, guys, is that as Peter acknowledged in Acts chapter 15, Jews and Gentiles alike will be saved through the same means, by the grace of God, through faith in Jesus Christ. And so Paul asked this question after just having said that the Jews have been unfaithful to following the law of God, to fulfilling the law of God, right? And yet God is still going to be faithful. God made promises of blessing and promises of curse, and he's going to be faithful to both of those promises, right? Deuteronomy chapter 28. But Paul continues this argument with this hypothetical objector, who again is probably a Jewish person, and he says, what then? Are we Jews any better off? Remember, Paul is still a Jew. He loves his countrymen. He loves his people. Later on in this letter, he's actually going to say, I wish that I could be accursed. I wish that I could die so that all of my countrymen can come and be saved. And so Paul is very much concerned for his people here, concerned for his ethnic people, guys. And so he includes himself here. He says, what then? Are we Jews better off? Now, this term, better off, it's kind of a, I don't know, I guess you can call it a conundrum, if you will, because in the Greek text, there's no other time that this term is used, better off. And you might be saying, well, so what, David, it doesn't matter. Well, it kind of does matter because we don't have a precedent anywhere else in the text. And I don't just mean in the Greek of the New Testament, but I mean even a transliterated Greek word from a Hebrew word in the Old Testament. We don't even have it there. And so the way that the translators decided to translate this, and guys, they're way smarter than me, okay? These guys are way smarter than me. But the way that they decided to is to say, are we Jews better off, okay? But really, the way they translated that actually could be translated in a different way depending on how you would translate it with the Greek. And I don't want to get into Greek and how it works and everything like that, but there actually is a case to where this actually could not be saying, are we Jews any better off? But it could be saying, are we Jews any worse off? Really, are we worse off than the Gentiles? It could say. And I kind of lean towards that translation, or that, I should say, interpretation, because earlier on here in chapter 3, what did Paul say? Is there any advantage to being a Jew? He's already answered that question. He's like, no, there's not. And so a Jew might say, okay, so are you saying that we Jews are worse off than the Gentiles then? And Paul is saying, no, not at all. And so the point is this, guys, is that whether it's are Jews better off or Gentiles better off or Jews worse off, the answer, no, not at all, fits with both. And I think that it's important that we see the point of verse 9, which continuing there, Paul says, no, not at all. Jews are not better off, for we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. And I think this is really the point that we want to see here, is that whether you're a Jew or whether you're a Greek, you are absolutely under sin today. All of mankind, all of humanity is under sin. Remember, Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 29 or 32 or whatever it is. We went through those verses. And remember, what came out of those verses is that mankind is ungodly. Mankind is unrighteous. And so this is the point here, guys, is that all mankind, both Jews and Gentiles, are under sin. Now, I love this word charged here because this is like a legal accusation against all mankind in the name of God coming from Paul, right? It's like if you were charged with a crime, right, because you broke a law. This is exactly what Paul is kind of doing here. He's doing a play on words by saying that we have already charged all of mankind as being unrighteous. All of mankind we see now, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. And so what do I mean, or rather, what does Paul mean when he says that all of mankind is under sin? Well, I will say this. This doesn't mean, nor is it talking about the right or wrong things that we do. It's not talking about, oh, okay, well, you know, I ran a stop sign the other day, or, you know, I went 65 on Highway 30 instead of 55. And none of us ever do that, right, brothers, right? We don't do that, right? Okay, so it's not saying that. It's not talking about the things that we do, okay? If I could give you an example, okay, it'd be the same. It'd be thinking of, like, being under sin would be like if you had a disease, but you have symptoms because of the disease. The symptoms are not the disease. Do you see it? The symptoms are the result of the disease. Our sin that we commit is a result of being under sin. You guys understand? You guys tracking with me here? And this is what Paul is talking about. And when he says that we are under sin, all of humanity is under sin, what he means is the power and the control and the guilt that comes from sin. We are all literally, guys, as kind of slaves to sin in the flesh, right? We are all helpless to escape the power of sin, to escape the control or the influence of sin. And literally, guys, this is why God had to intervene from the outside. Because in and of ourselves, guys, we are controlled and powered, or I should say the authority of sin is over us, guys. And you guys know how this happened, right? God did not make us this way. How did this happen? Well, it happened from the fall in the garden. We all are under sin. We all are held by the power and the influence and the authority of sin in our flesh. And so, guys, whether you're Jew or you're Gentile, neither of us have an advantage over another, okay? Because the fact is, as Paul says here, is that all of us are under the controlling power of sin in our lives. And this is what Paul is coming to right here. This is really where Paul is getting to the matter here. Like, I can dub you unrighteous, but what does that mean? Why am I unrighteous? We talked about this a couple of weeks ago. God will judge each and every person according to his law. Whether or not you knew the law, you did or you didn't know the law, you had the law, you did or you didn't have the law, whatever. God is going to judge your works against the law. Literally the standard, which is Jesus Christ. Okay? But no one has an advantage over anybody, regardless of ethnicity, class, gender, or whatever, because all of us are controlled by the power of sin. All of us are under sin. Continuing there, Paul will now give support for what he just said, that all of us are under sin. And what's crazy about this is he's going to give support from the Old Testament. I think I told you guys this when we started the book of Romans. Paul will often quote Old Testament scripture in a lot of his epistles. In Romans, he quotes the most out of the Old Testament. And literally from verses 10 through 18, which we're going to go through right now, he's quoting a lot of Old Testament scripture. And he's using it to support his statement that all mankind, Jew or Gentile, is under sin. So look at what he says here. He says, as it is written. You see it? As it is written where? As it is written, you know, in the Old Testament. As it is written in God's words. As it is written in the Torah, right? You guys see this? He says, none is righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. And so, today we had Brother Tim read Psalm 14 for the reading. And I don't know if you noticed, but a lot of what Paul just said here comes out of Psalm 14. He is quoting Psalm 14. He also is quoting from Ecclesiastes 7:20. But again, he's using these to support his claim that all mankind is under sin. So when he says none is righteous, right? I keep saying this, guys. If you had to pick a main theme of the book of Romans, okay, this is the main theme, the righteousness of God. And when Paul says none is righteous here, okay, he's literally saying none is righteous when you compare them to God, right? I just said a moment ago that God is going to judge everybody's works, right, based on the law. Now, you guys are saying, well, wait a minute, I thought I was saved. You are saved, right? But God is going to judge your works, right? Really, your works or Jesus' works for you based on the law. Jesus is the standard because Jesus lived on the planet. It says he was tempted in every way, and yet he did not sin. And so it's Jesus' righteousness, his righteous works, that God is going to judge you and all believers based on. Do you guys see that? But when we talk about ourselves, our own flesh, right? And specifically those of unbelievers who will never put their faith in Jesus Christ, okay? They're not righteous. And in and of ourselves, we're not righteous. Again, all mankind is unrighteous before God. And I'll just say this, guys, look, we can all find probably a bunch of people that we are more righteous or more moral than, right? If God said, Dave, I'll let you choose anybody you want to pick, right? So, and I'll base your righteousness off of that. I would just go pick Hitler or Stalin or Mao or somebody, right? Somebody really evil to make sure that I'm in, okay? We could always find somebody else, right, who we think in our minds that we are more righteous than, but God only uses one standard, and that is Jesus Christ. Romans 3:23, later on in this very chapter, it's going to say, for all fall short of the glory of God. Literally, we fall short of the standard of God's law, and the standard is Jesus the Christ. Look at what Ecclesiastes 7:20 says there, though. It says, surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins. I mean, this is right here in the Old Testament. I mean, just wisdom from Solomon, truth, right? Now, this is cool because in this verse, again, it says, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands and no one seeks for God. I love this, guys, because Paul defines our unrighteousness as two things. First of all, that we do not understand. And secondly, that we do not seek after God. And so when Paul says no one understands, I want to remind you here, he just got through saying that we're all under sin. What he means is that the effect of being under sin causes confusion in all of humanity, in all people, in all cultures, and in all societies. There is great confusion. And when I say great confusion, I mean confusion when you compare it to the truth. And when I say the truth, I mean God and the way that he intended us to live and to function as his created beings and in his creation, guys. And so there's a great deficiency in man's understanding of that truth of God. And again, that truth can only be found in God's knowledge. Literally, only can be found in Jesus. Jesus says, I am the truth, right? And because there's a great deficiency of man's understanding of God's knowledge, this causes great confusion in all other things in our life. And the reason why, guys, and I don't know if you guys knew this or not, and I hope that you did, all things in creation have their meaning only in God. All things in creation have their meaning only in God. And so let me give you some examples here, okay? There's a lot of confusion in a whole lot of different things. Would you guys not agree? You see confusion in parenting, right? I mean, you know, I'm not going to speak, but, well, I am going to speak, okay? Because, you know, I've been a youth pastor to the kids in this community since 2008, all right? And there are some really, really confused parents who think that by letting their kids do whatever they want to do, right, and give their kids everything that they want and not let their kids ever be held accountable by any authority figure, that somehow they're loving their kid and they're raising them in the right way. You guys see this? How about in governing, right? You got a politician who professes Christianity, right? Yet he is for things that contradict the word of God. And I don't want to get political here, but I'm sorry. Abortion is not something that God wants us to partake in. That's called murder. But there are politicians who profess the name of Jesus Christ, and yet they say, well, God gave us the gift of abortion. Or they say, God is for abortion. I mean, these are things that really are evidence of the confusion of mankind when it comes to the truth of God's knowledge. And again, all things find their meaning in God. Now, I will say this. Many people have correctly recognized over the centuries that, well, this must be a spiritual issue. And they're right. They very much are right. But here's the problem, okay? They never actually go to the one or seek for the one that can help them with the spiritual problem. Hence what Paul says next. Not only does no one understand, but no one seeks for God. Well, I understand it's a spiritual issue. So what do? They get into this New Age religion stuff, right? They believe in demons and angels, but they don't believe in God who created demons, or rather created angels, I should say. Do you guys see this? And so there's a whole lot of confusion that comes from being under sin. And again, the fact that we're not righteous shouts these two truths, that we do not understand the knowledge of God, hence we're confused, and therefore we do not seek after God. Now, I will say this, guys, there are some people who would say, Dave, you're wrong. You know, we see people seeking after God as they partake in their religion, right? But I'll just say this, brothers and sisters, there is no religion that is going to save you. As a matter of fact, I believe that religion is initiated by man. And I also know through Scripture that we must be approached by God, that it must be God that initiates it with us, guys, okay? And the reason why I know this, you know, he'll come to us, is because the Trinity shows us this in the Word of God. It's the Holy Spirit who convicts the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. I know this personally. The day I got saved, I know this. I wasn't looking for God, but he was knocking on my door many a time, and I just ignored him and ignored him and ignored him until one day it was time. But he had initiated all of that. I wasn't seeking after God when I was living in the world. So the Holy Spirit, he convicts. Jesus says that we can only come to the Father through him. Again, there's Jesus, God the Son. And then the Father, it says in the Word, that we can only come to Jesus through him. Do you guys see this? And so what I want you to see here, guys, is that look, religion, okay, and yes, there is one religion that is pure and undefiled, and that is love, right? The law of liberty, the law of Christ, to love, right? To visit the widow and the orphan and to keep yourself unstained, right, from the world. That's in the book of James, right? But the point is this, is that when God initiates that with you, that's actually what happens. That's what happens in your life. Now, on the other side of this, many will say that, well, I did try to seek God. I'm seeking God now, but I just cannot seem to find him, okay? I will just say this, guys, that there's two reasons for this, okay? It's either because they're not seeking God with all their heart and with all their soul, as Moses said in Deuteronomy 4:29, or they're really not seeking God at all. And how do I know that? Because, again, Jesus is not a liar, and look what Jesus says in Matthew 7:7. Jesus says, seek and you shall find. God is not hiding himself from us, guys. God is not trying to, you know, I remember when you were kids, you were playing hide and seek and stuff, hiding behind a tree or something, you know, or hiding up in a tree. I used to do that all the time. And I would hide, we'd make up rules like, well, you can't move from your spot. You got to stay in your spot. Oh, I moved like 8 times. You know what I'm saying? If someone would come by and I knew, well, the next time they're going to come by, they're going to find me, so I'm going to move, you know. And so God is not doing that, brothers and sisters. God makes himself plain to many people. And again, like I said, I know this. God was calling me all of my life. I was in the world for 27 years. And then finally, when I came to the Lord, when the conviction of the Holy Spirit finally pushed me over the top, I realized it clicked. I said, oh my gosh, God has been calling me my whole life. It is God that initiates our seeking of him, guys. The simple fact is, guys, is that if somebody wants to truly find God, they will find him. God wills that all would be saved. God wills that all would come into the knowledge of the truth and repent. That's our God. And so because people aren't truly seeking God, what does Paul continue with there? He says, all have turned aside. Do you see this? All have turned aside. They've turned aside from God. They went every other way they can. You guys remember, what's his name? Is this Carl Sagan? Is that his name? The evolution guy? Remember what he said? We will follow the path till it leads us to truth. Remember that guy? Something to that respect when he gave about evolution? Well, what he really meant was we will follow the truth wherever it leads us as long as it doesn't lead us to God. That's what he really meant, guys. And so again, everybody's turned aside from God. They went every other way they can. And because of that, what does Paul say there? Again, quoting Psalm 14, he says, they have all become worthless and no one does good, not even one. When it says worthless here, guys, I mean, this is what it means. It means worthless. It means unprofitable. Some translations will say useless. Everybody has become worthless, unprofitable, and useless because they don't seek after God. And ultimately, what happens from that? Well, it just means the truth that no one does good. No one does good. And I know some of you might be thinking, well, Dave, sometimes I do good. Sometimes, you know, I help people. I, you know, help my neighbors sometimes, or, you know, I do this kind of a thing, you know. But really, what the Greek is saying here when it says does, it means always, only does good. This is what this means. Again, the standard is Jesus Christ. Now, these verses here from Psalm 14, as we saw when Brother Tim read it today, these speak about the fool who says that there is no God. And really what they're doing when they say that there is no God is they're making an excuse for why they live the way that they live. And so I just want to say this to you guys, and we'll continue here in verses 13 and 14, that if you want to seek and understand God, you can only do it by faith in Christ. You can only do it by the Holy Spirit, walking in the Holy Spirit by faith in Christ. And so Paul gives these general statements again about the human condition. No one's righteous. No one's good. No one has any worth. All of us are unprofitable, right? And now he gets into some specific human actions. Verses 13 and 14. Paul says this: their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. And so the effect of being under sin makes us unrighteous. The effect of being under sin makes us unprofitable. The effects of being under sin makes us no good. And now Paul says the effects of being under sin causes us to sin with our speech, literally to speak destructively. Paul says this, again, their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. Brothers and sisters, it is man's inclination to literally cause death with their speech. And I know that sounds really dramatic, but I didn't say that. The word says that. Look at Proverbs 18:21. It says this: death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. Do you guys see that? And then Paul says that there is venom of asps under their lips. Brothers and sisters, it is man's inclination to use speech like poison to others. You see this, guys? I mean, this is crazy stuff, you know? I'm not trying to make anybody feel bad. I'm just saying, like, this is our inclination in the flesh. And then Paul talks about how the mouth brings curses and bitterness. Literally speaking evil upon somebody, hoping that it happens to them. I can't tell you how many times, brothers and sisters, when I was in the world that I did that. James 3, 6 through 8 says this: the tongue is a fire in a world of unrighteousness. Then it says, no human can tame the tongue. It's restless evil full of deadly poison. Now, I want to say this as we continue here. If you want to speak life into people's lives, again, you can only do it by faith in Jesus Christ and by the power of the Holy Spirit. Proverbs 10:11 says, "The mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked conceals violence." Let's continue there, verses 15 through 17. Paul says, "Their feet are swift to shed blood, and their paths are ruin and misery, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes." So again, being under sin causes us to sin with our speech. Being under sin causes us to be violent. Now, I don't think I need to tell you guys this to be a truth. Just go look at the news. I think there's, so far this year alone, there's been about 360 mass shootings in America. Last year, we had 19,152 murders. I'm not talking about, you know, accidental deaths or somebody accidentally killed. I'm talking about intended murders in our country. Being under sin causes us to be violent. These things are very evident, and we see them plain as day, guys. Paul, as he continued there, and I already read, but I'll read it again. It says that in their paths are ruin and misery. I don't think I need to speak on that. I just got through talking about confused parenting, right? Sadly, you know, because I have known a lot of the kids since 2008, growing up in the community, and I do have contact with them sometimes, or I see them at the football games or somewhere, or I hear about what they're doing. You know, I hear some kids, you know, who have grown up in this community who are living up in our woods because they're so jacked up on drugs. You know, I hear of other kids, you know, who are in jail. You know, I have heard some good things. We actually did coach a kid who actually was, a Secret Service guy to one of the presidents. So go figure that, you know. And I don't know if he was like officially Secret Service, but I know that he was in the Army and one of the Rangers. And so one of his detail was to guard the president. You know, he lived right here in Swenson, Annapolis, Swenson. Actually, pretty cool. But the fact is, guys, is that being under sin, we can see it. We can see what it's done. We can see what it does. Again, quick to shed blood. Our path is ruin and misery. And the way of peace they have not known. Brothers and sisters, I don't need to tell you about that either, right? I remember years ago, there was this bumper sticker. And I actually had heard it from our pastor down in San Diego, where I got saved at our church. But I had saw it later on as we were traveling one time. There was this bumper sticker, and it said, "No peace, no God." And it spelled it out, N-O, no peace, no God. But under that, it said, "No peace, no God." And it's spelled K-N-O-W, K-N-O-W. Do you guys see this? If you want to know the way in the path of peace, his name is Jesus Christ. Put your faith in him, and you will have that. But in the world, that is not the way that humanity is. There is not peace. I mean, we got two wars going on that we know of, right? I know that there's other wars that we're not aware of in other countries, and I'm positive there's other wars that America's fighting that we're not privy to know. But there is war everywhere in the world. There is not peace in the world. And we fight over the dumbest things, and we fight over things. I mean, you know, it just reminds me of, you know, a couple of kids, you know, in the bedroom playing with their toys and fighting over a toy. You know, that's what we do. And we will go to great lengths to have that thing. It's all part of the disease of being under sin of mankind. And then the final one here in verse 18, it says, "There is no fear of God before their eyes." Now, I don't know if you guys saw that before I speak to that really quickly. It's really cool because Paul has been using like different parts of the body to show the activity, the sinful activity of man as a result of man being under sin, right? The throat, the mouth, the lips, right? The feet. And then he comes back to the eyes. And if you want to be technical at the beginning of this, he was using the mind, you know? But all of the things that Paul mentions are parts of the human anatomy. And all of them, being under sin, are used to sin. But this final one here, guys, where Paul writes, no one fears God. There's no fear of God, rather, before their eyes. Being under sin causes every rebellion against God, and it removes all and any fear of God. Hence, our habitual iniquity and wickedness. Hence, again, the things that we do, our sinfulness, our sin. And I'll just say this, brothers and sisters, is where there is sin, there is no fear of God. I know some people will try to use grace, as we talked about last week, as a license to sin. But if you really believed that there was somebody that transcended you and that watches your every moment and your every move, okay, then you would realize that when you sin, in essence, what you are saying to a righteous God is that I don't fear you in this sin. Now, granted, sometimes, you know, we stumble, we fall, and that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the habitual sin. And again, this fear or this lack of fear from the world is another symptom of being under sin. And I'll just say this too, guys, that without God, we have no power not to sin. It's in our nature. So what I love about these verses, guys, is that Paul uses these Old Testament verses, which, again, are the words of God, which, again, are the Jews' own scriptures, right, to reveal the same sinfulness that the Jews have that the Gentiles have. You guys see this? And so, look, brothers and sisters, if you don't want to live in sin, if you don't want to be, you know, subject to falling and stumbling in sin, then live for Christ. Live for Christ by the Holy Spirit. I love what Paul writes in Galatians 2:20. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Let's finish up those last two verses. Paul continues and he says, now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. So again, as we started earlier, you know, Paul tells us in verse 9 that all of mankind is under sin. And then he just got through with verses 10 through 18, give support and evidence to show that indeed all of mankind is under sin. And what he's doing here in these last couple of verses here, verses 19 and 20, is that he is showing the reason that God gave the law to the Jews. And I'll just say this, brothers and sisters, and we should know this by now, he did not give the law to the Jews as a means by which they could be saved, but he rather gave them the law to reveal this truth, that ever since the fall, all mankind is under sin. I'll read it again, verse 20. It says, for by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight. He says, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. Again, this is why God gave the law. Paul will say later on in this letter, Romans 7, that the law was given to show sinfulness in its fullness, to show us how sinful that we really are. It was not a means by which a person could be saved. We already start out, you know, not saved. We already start out unrighteous, right? That from the moment we're born because of the fall, right? We already start out under sin, with a sin nature. And so again, the law was never given to save. It was given to reveal that truth that Paul said in verse 9, that all mankind is under sin. Now back in verse 19, I love this because it says that we know that the law, that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law. It says this, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be accountable to God. And so this just goes back to what Paul's been saying, that there's nobody that has an excuse, there's nobody that has justification for themselves, for why they live the way that they live. In other words, when you go before God, you cannot use an excuse. You guys remember the famous Adam excuse? Well, God, you know, I never would have ate from the tree, but you know, that woman you gave me, she made me do it, you know, kind of a thing, right? There is no excuse for any of us at all, that every mouth may be stopped. And I love this because, look, this isn't just Paul saying this here as a matter of fact. Paul is, again, going back from themes in the Old Testament. For you note takers, Job 5, verse 16, Psalm 63, verse 11, and Psalm 107, 42. All of these speak to the fact that, look, mankind, you cannot give an excuse. I'm going to shut your mouth. And look, God is not trying to stop you from giving an excuse because he doesn't want to hear it, but he's trying to stop you because he doesn't want you to end up perishing. The more opportunity that we have to make excuses, the more excuses that we make, the further off we are from God. Again, this is the reason for the gospel, for the articulation of the gospel. Romans 1:16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation." It literally speaks the truth. It says nobody has an excuse. And what does man do? They get mad. It's not my fault. Well, this is my excuse. Oh, God wants to shut my mouth? I can't take, guys, growing up in, you know, in the hard circumstances that I grew up in, you know, ghettos in San Diego, when I didn't shut my mouth every time against somebody that I should, I got punched. And the reality is that God wants to prevent that from happening to you and I and all the world for all eternity. And yet we get mad because God wants to shut our mouth. It would behoove us to shut our mouth so that every mouth may be stopped, Paul says. And I love this. And the whole world may be accountable to God. When he says the whole world, again, he's talking about all of mankind, be them Jew or be them Gentile. He wants all men to know, all people to know, that they stand unrighteous and condemned. And the only way that they're going to be right before God on Judgment Day is if they put their faith and their trust in Jesus Christ, if they appeal to the mercy and the grace of God. So again, brothers and sisters, God, through Paul in this letter, is showing us that we are all under sin, that we are all condemned, and he's doing it to cause us to turn back to him. So look, if you have turned to him, if you have placed your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, and I know most of you in the room, and I know you have, praise the Lord. But we still got work to do. This is what Brother Tim was talking about a moment ago, because there are people out here who don't know. There are people in our community who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, and it absolutely horrifies me to think that even one of them who lives so close to me might end up in hell for all eternity. And this is the warning of the gospel. We speak so often, oh, well, the gospel, you know, for God so loves us, he just loves us so much, and he saved us, and blah, blah. Yes, but he had to save us. There was no other way. And we need to let the world know that we're all under sin. We need to let the world know about the coming imminent judgment of God on the world, which again in Romans 1 tells us eternal wrath for those who do not believe in Jesus Christ. So again, as I finish up here, brothers and sisters, I can't say it enough. I'm not trying to make you feel bad. I'm trying to make you turn to God. I'm trying to make you see the love of God. And more importantly, that's what God's trying to do here, is that all mankind is unrighteous before God. And the only one who is righteous, right, is God. And since we're all unrighteous, our works cannot and will not justify us before God. And since only God is righteous, only God is justified, and only God can justify. We will talk about this next week. So what I want you to realize today, brothers and sisters, is simply that. You guys understand this. This is what we call, again, our sin nature. This is what the Bible calls the works of the flesh, right? We are all under sin, and we need to realize that. No type or no amount of works, what we are, what we have, what we know, what we do in and of ourselves can justify us before God. So I want to encourage all of you. I want the way you can apply this today, this word, which is a hard word, and I promise you it'll be nicer next week, okay? But the way that you can apply it is stop living like somehow your works will justify you. And rest in Christ. Rest in Christ by living by the only thing that can justify you. Faith in Christ by the grace of God. Look at Galatians 3:24. It says this, "So then the law was our guardian until Christ came." Christ has come and gone. He is in heaven now. He makes intercession all day long for the elect, right? It says, "So then the law was our guardian until Christ came in order that we might be justified by faith." Again, we'll talk about this next week. But what I want to tell you in closing here, brothers and sisters, is that let us live under the grace of God by faith in Jesus Christ. I know that it's hard. I know that it is. But let us do this, guys. Let us rely on God's grace. Let us trust in God's promises. Let us constantly read the Word of God, which pushes us towards God in His grace. Let us pray regularly. Let us obey God by the power of the Holy Spirit. And let us continue in the hope and the assurance that we have in Jesus Christ, by faith in Jesus Christ. Now, we can do this, brothers and sisters. We can. We can do this because we have the Holy Spirit. Philippians 4:13, we know that one by heart, right? I got a coffee mug that says it. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. The implication there is I can't do it without Him. Run to Jesus, my brothers and sisters. The final thing I want to say is that we're all under sin in the flesh, okay? But we're freed from it by and in God's grace through faith. I want to read to you what, in closing, I want to read to you what Paul had asked God to do as he had asked God to take away his thorn. And I want to read to you how also in this reading, how God replied to him. Listen to what Paul writes here. 2 Corinthians 12:9-10 says, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" Brothers and sisters, live under the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ. The last and final thing I want to say is if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ today, I ask you please to see where you stand, to understand that all of us are under sin, that all of us without Jesus Christ sit and stand ready to be condemned and judged, sit and stand to receive the wrath of God. But God loves you. God doesn't care where you are today. God wants you now how you are. And if you would just simply repent of your sin and place your faith and your trust in Jesus, God will receive you into His kingdom. He will receive you into His family with open arms. I pray indeed you would do that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this revelation for some and maybe a reminder for others, God, that in the flesh, in and of ourselves, we are under sin, that we do stand condemned. We do stand judged before you, who is the only one who is good and the only one who is righteous and the only one who is justified. But we thank you, God, that through faith in your Son, you become our justifier. Through faith in your Son, we receive righteous salvation because of your Son, because of Jesus Christ, because of his sacrifice, his life, his death, his resurrection. Thank you, Jesus. And I just want to pray, God, if there's any of us in the room today, God, in any areas of our life where maybe we've just been working. Maybe, God, we've just been putting it on ourselves, trying to do it by our own willpower. I just pray, God, that you would let us repent that. Let us see, God, that we're punching a brick wall. Let us lay it down at the foot of the cross. Let us rest in your grace. Again, as Paul asked you to remove his thorn, and you said, my grace is sufficient for you. We ask you, God, to help us, God, to see that your grace is sufficient for us. Help us to do that not only just today or this week, God, but let us do it for the rest of our lives. Help us by your Spirit, God. Help us to walk by faith in Jesus. I also want to pray for those that don't know you today, Lord, that don't know Jesus as God and Savior. I pray, Lord, that they would see where they stand so far off from you, yet so near, a simple word of faith. And I pray indeed they would repent of their sin and place their faith and their trust in Jesus and receive salvation. God, we love you so much, and we thank you for your great love for us. We thank you for your Spirit. We just ask, Holy Spirit, we continue to reign in the service, lead and guide it. And we thank you for Jesus, again, who is our righteousness, who is our justification, who is our Savior, our King, and our God. Again, we pray these things in his name. Amen.
As we enter into our prayer time, we have a few requests on Brother Chris Wilson. He's hunting today. So pray that he would be successful in that and be able to bring some meat home. Be praying for Emery Griffin Hoagland. Has advanced cancer, but be praying for healing and courage, comfort and strength for the family. Many of you will remember Mariana and Dakota because you know them well. They are moving to Iowa on Monday, so please keep them in your prayers today. Praying for Sister Nina, her health and healing. Youth group retreats coming up on November 1st through the 3rd. On that weekend, be praying for kids to be interested, kids to be going from the high school. Have quite a few other prayer requests we've had on here for healing. Tracy, Grandma Margaret, Daniel Wallace, Daisha Jacobson, and David Espinoza. Please be praying for all of them and their healing. Praying, I guess we can't call it summer event, but kind of closing up the summer, beginning the fall. The youth group is going to be partaking in a youth car wash and trying to raise some funds for the retreat for that. And then just be praying that we would, as a church and as individuals, that we would be strengthened to be able to reach this community for Christ. Those are kind of the things I'd like you to consider today and throughout the week as we go along. And today I'd just like us to take a little bit extra time and just be talking with the Lord and having him show us where we've relied on our own things, where we haven't feared him, had the fear of the Lord in our own lives, and maybe have just gone astray from him, and confess those to him and go forward. Yes. For Israel and the Jews right now too, yes, we can do that as well. Okay. I'm going to give you about a minute to be able to pray, and then I will close us up, and then hopefully that will be a kickstart for the rest of your week of prayer. We praise you and praise you for your goodness, your greatness, how you've touched everything around us, how you love everyone and want the best for them. Lord, we come to you today and confess that we do not always fear you. We decide that we should try to get away with us something or not do something that you have asked. Lord, forgive us, please. We look to you for grace and mercy. Help change our hearts, keep them soft, so that we will respond to you and what you would have us do. Lord, we have lots and lots of requests. Some big and global, like Israel and Ukraine and other things going on around the world that can have an effect on millions of people. And some a lot closer to home, like touching and healing those we know and care for and love and are in our families. Lord, we especially lift up Dakota and Mariana as they're getting ready to move, just asking that you would be with them, that you would lead them, that you would help them to be a light as they move to Iowa. Pray for Nina as well, that you would touch her and heal her. And all the other things that we believe that you are having us work through, we lift up to you, we put in your feet, knowing that it is not our strength and not our efforts that are going to bring about the results that you desire, the righteous life that you desire, but it's us giving of ourselves, us giving of our life back to you and following you in your direction and your leading. Help us keep you at the forefront. Help us to keep you as our aim, as our target, as our direction, as our God. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God. I am. this service and we go out into the week, Lord, may we start our days with you. May we know that all that we have and all that we need, Lord, is found in you. And may we not stray from that path or that knowledge, Father God. We thank you for this time and this place, Lord. May your spirit be present, Lord, as we're fellowshipping together, Lord, and for the rest of this day, Lord. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Have a blessed week.